Meatloaf was so much larger than life. He was, always. You know, he was like a carnival act in a way.
He's the only time I've ever toured with a rock star.
We had a big fight one night where I had to sit on the stage and play the banjo, and he was in back of me doing the closing monologue for the show. And he decided to put his big boots and legs onto my shoulders as if I was his footstool. So first I just sort of shrugged to let him go.
Okay, but Larry doesn't like to improvise.
Well, I also don't like to improvise here with somebody's giant boots.
No, your
in
ego
my
got
face.
In the way.
My ego got in the way as well. Anyway, finally I ended up storming off and going, fuck you, man. And Meatloaf, you know, closed the show like that, came backstage, picked up a desk and threw it at me and was storming at me, yelling, you're throwing knives in the fire, man. You're throwing knives in the fire. I remember going, wait a minute, knives in the fire? What is that? What is this metaphor? What do the knives have to do with the fire?
Jim would rent these piano rooms, and I loved to hear him play. So he would say, do you want to come down to NOLA Studios? And I'm like, yeah. So we would just sit around and he would play these songs. What do you think of this one? What do you think of that one? And I remember Left in the Dark Again. I remember Bad Out of Hell, certainly. I remember one that really moved me, which is It's All Coming Back to Me Now. Mm-hmm. I thought that was so beautiful.
Yeah.
And so there were a lot of the really beautiful songs that he would play for me. But at one point I said, you know, Stein, what I really want to hear, because it was so beautiful. And he would do these ironic lyrics that would have twists in them. And I'm a romantic girl, so I want to hear just the romance with this beautiful music. And I said, you know, write just, I want you, I need you, I love you, like Elvis, you know, did those kinds of songs. And he said, oh, that's what you want me? Yeah, with his heart. And I'm like, it would just be cool.
I want you, I need you, I love you. More and more.
I said, I've never heard such beautiful music, and I it was very romantic to me. So, you know, he called me back about a week later and went, okay, so you know that song that you told me that you wanted? Okay, I started it, and it was so beautiful that I want you, I need you. And then came the Steinman twist of irony. There ain't no way I'm ever gonna love you. Don't be sad, because 2 out of 3 ain't bad.
Now don't be sad, because 2 out of 3 ain't bad.
There was another time we were watching TV, and I think it was the Mets or the Yankees, I'm not sure, but they were losing. And we had this little TV, black and white, it was the first one we ever got, in order to watch baseball, but we would be on the phone with Stein watching the game because his apartment was over on the west side. And I said, oh, they really were bad. And they were bad tonight. And he goes, you don't think they're not going to pull out of this and win the pennant? I went, no, I think they're going to be bad for good. He went, bad for good? Oh my God, that's so great. I got to make a song.
Gonna be like this forever. I'm never gonna be what I should. And you think that I'll be bad for just a little.
There was another time he said, I want to write a song. He said, I need verses for chilly California wind. Just going down our bodies again. We're sinking deeper and deeper in the chilly California. It took the words right out of my mouth. He said, I got this thing that took the words right out of my mouth, but I don't know what to do with it. So I wrote some lyric and I went, here, you know, here's a lyric. He said, oh, good. You wrote some lyric. He asked me. And I think it started with, we were sitting in the back of the bar. Love was just a minute away. You were licking your lips and your lipstick shine. And I was dying just to ask for a taste. That was part of my lyric in there.
While you were licking your lips and your lipstick shine.
because he kept those lyrics and he threw out the whole rest of the one, because the kind of lyrics I wrote were very pedestrian and very, you know, four lines, chorus, four line verse and a chorus. And he was all over the place, but he did use those.
Yeah. He was also, he would edit his songs for months and months.
Oh, I know.
You know, and, you know, run every single line by, you know, like 12 or 15 people. Yeah. Well, I met Jim Steinman in junior high school. He was a strange, intellectual, neurasthenic, actively anti-athlete, musician, politician, freak. He was very funny, very rebellious, very, very bright. Anyway, Jim and I both applied to Amherst College, as well as a bunch of other people in our class who were, you know, the valedictorian did, the captain of the basketball team did, and we got in and these other people didn't. Before he went, his psychiatrist had told the parents he comes never going to make it in college, because he used to stay home all the time and listen to opera and not go to school.
Opera.
And they said, and he seemed like a fragile human being. He came to college and he emerged. He just sort of popped out as this, you know, this sort of star.
Artist.
Artist. We had a band, I think, the end of freshman year and certainly our sophomore year, called Things to Go Bump in the Night. Steinman would, he played the piano and he would do these monologues where he would wrap himself in the guitar chord, you know, like he was being contained by the guitar chord, and do these long sexually charged monologues about the wife of the president of the college and having sex with her and stuff like that. And people go nuts. He was, you know, funny and kind of dangerous, because he was so into it that you had no idea where this guy was going to go. When I was in LA, and Stein was out here, Meat Loaf came out because Rocky Horror Show, the stage version of the show, came to the Roxy in LA. They did a residency there. So I met him there at the opening party. And that was when I just thought, this guy's amazing. You know, this is a real character. Steinman got a gig creating some music for a show called More Than You Deserve, which Michael Weller had written. And they got Meat Loaf to do it.
Won't you take some more, boy? It's more than you deserve.
I remember Steinman saying, this guy auditioned today and we're going to have this guy in the play named Meatloaf. Meatloaf, you know, the first time you hear that, you're like, what? And he said, yeah, he has the voice of an angel. So Stein really came to rock and roll through the theater and took Meatloaf with him. And what's funny is the National Lampoon tour that we were on, because we were just friends with Stein and, you know, we were between jobs, and Larry had been in his band in college, and I had been in Das Rheingold, which we've kind of skipped over, but it was a version of Rheingold as a rock musical. And it was done at the Mercer Arts Center in downtown New York City, near public theater, but not the public theater. Das Rheingold happened, and then More Than You Deserve, and then National Lampoon. Somehow, because I was in Greece, the musical, and, you know, I'm an actor, so I keep getting these jobs, and the National Lampoon show was on 54th Street in some cabaret. And we went to see it, and it was hilarious. Bill Murray, never saw him before. Gilda and John Belushi. I don't think we had seen Belushi, certainly, in Lemmings, but I hadn't seen Gilda. And there it all was, and it was hysterically funny. And they all got hired by Lorne Michaels to do this new show called Saturday Night.
They didn't all get hired. Because
Bill Murray didn't,
because Howard Cosell had a show that went against Saturday Night Live. Howard Cosell was on ABC, and he took Billy Murray and Chris Guest, and then the others went to Saturday Night Live.
So that happened. So then the National Lampoon show wanted to make money on a college tour with this hit National Lampoon show, but they didn't have their cast anymore. Meanwhile, I want to audition to be on Saturday Night Live. And I asked Stein to play for me because I've written these two parody songs of I Am Woman and I'm Having Your Baby. And he goes, well, I'm playing for Meat's audition. You know, they love him. So Meat will audition for Saturday Night Live and then I'll play for you. It was a successful audition and that's a whole other story. But meanwhile, Lorne Michaels called me and said, look, we need a piece of white bread for the not ready for primetime players. And so we can only use you, you know, for some of the sketches and I will use you if you stay in New York. But it sounds like you've already been hired for this National Lampoon tour. Somehow we had already been offered that with Ellen Foley, Larry, Meatloaf, Jim Hosbein and Barry Diamond and Stein playing the piano. And he said, maybe you should go on that tour. It sounds like what you're supposed to do. And you're already with that guy. You know, he knew about my relationship. So, you know, we went on the National Lampoon tour. And so that was so like basic. We were driving around in a van and a car. We were driving around in Barry Diamond's car.
We hated the van so much. We convinced Barry to get his car.
To get his own car. And, you know, we were just on the road and we did a different college every night up and down the Eastern Seaboard.
Meatloaf used to rip his pants every night and Mimi had to sew his pants. We had no other crew. So
I was the seamstress and the costume mistress. And as I say, it was really basic, but that was when we just hung out with Meatloaf and he was playful. You know, he really was like a kid, at least as I knew him up. But all of my memories of Meatloaf are from that time. So we're all incredibly young. And Steinman was writing Bad Out of Hell. So every night we'd get into these college, usually student centers, auditoriums. They were usually rackety sounding basketball courts or something with a stage platform set up and a piano on the stage. And Steinman would get in there, you know, an hour early and start rolling out this incredibly beautiful music, just stately, marching, gorgeous rock and roll. And then he would say sometimes to us, what do you think of this one? And then he would sing us the new song. And then, you know, it was half hour and we had to get off the stage, you know, and go back to the lavatory, which was the green room. And we did that for many months. That was the beginning of Bad Out of Hell. We went up to Bearsville and we were there. That was my dream. We were sitting on the floor of the recording studio one night and Roy Bittan, who is E Street Bruce's Band, name. Bruce's, you know, and Max, his drummer, E Street Band drummer, and Todd Rundgren, Be Still My Heart. I wrote him a fan letter, you know, 10 years before. I was certainly hoping at that point he'd never gotten it or would remember it. But, you know, watching that all, it was rehearsal. They were recording that night so we could be there. But it was really cool. And Steinman was generous about that.
When Bad Out of Hell came out, or when, you know, when the hits came out by other people, I mean, we were always just like over the moon. This is so great. This is so cool. You
know, and so. Steinman was really funny. That's the other thing. He loved us and we loved him because we would just talk until 4 a.m, just, you know, saying right. Jokes and making up joke songs. Mama was a big dog, Daddy was a whole hog. You know,
his lifestyle remained the same basically from, you know, freshman year in college through the rest of his life.
That's true. When we got serious and we got married and then I got pregnant, that alley had to stop.
And especially when we had kids.
We couldn't do that anymore. And that's why I say these memories are really of our youth. Steinman always had that music in him. And I don't know Marvin a day, you know, Meatloaf well enough to know what was always in him. But I know that when they met each other, they gave great music to the world.
They really did.